Yes, I was just going to say those little string flourishes I think are one of my favourite parts on the record, like those camp. Oh. I also do like She's Returned and she, now she's cleaning her arse.
Yeah, Cactus is just like, I'm off.
Hi, we are CHVRCHES and this is our NME track by track for Screen Violence.
It was something that Martin suggested quite early on in the conversation about what songs go on the album and what the sequence would be. And he said that the opener of Asking for a Friend, the slow build into the big sort of euphoric moment, and then bang into He Said, She Said, is like a great sort of opening couple for the record. And immediately we were like, hell yeah, that totally works.
I was just trying to get a bit of drama going, you know, that showbiz. Normally, like, everyone's like, oh, put the single on. The first song on your album's got to be the single. I reject that as a requirement for putting out an album these days.
Yeah, it's a bit telling a story.
Yeah, I was trying to make it just, like, a bit, you know, bring people in a little bit more. I also just really like the lyric. I just thought it would be, what could be more, extreme than just the first song on the album just listing all things that are wrong with yourself, like, is really raw and kind of an indicator of where Lauren was going lyrically. And I thought that was kind of a cool thing to do.
Obviously, there's nothing wrong with me. I'm perfect.
You know, well, all the ways that, you know, your perceived personal flaws, whatever. Yeah, but
I always feel like, yeah, you got to get the first punch in. Nobody thinks I'm a bigger piece of shit than I do. So,
well, there you go. That's
it. This is just gonna, yeah.
Well, they said if you're where it goes on the album is like, well, if you can't put the single on track one, you better put it on track two. No, none of that. I think it was just one of the ones that are definitely, we connected with it really fast. It was the first thing that we did together, like after like a long period away. So I guess that there was a lot of things about that song that felt right to be the first piece of music that anybody heard.
Yeah, and I like the juxtaposition between two voices on the record, like not literal voices, but like the two perspectives on the record almost. Like, I feel like now I can look back on it and be like, there's songs that are written from lyrically from a more assertive point of view, which I guess is the more like performance persona part of me and part of the band. And then there's the other stuff that's the more like what I actually think, like what I'm actually like. Like, I feel like Good Girls and He Said, She Said are songs that I'm like, yes, this is how I would love to think and how I'd love to conduct myself in the world, and fuck this and fuck that and fuck you. But then the other ones are, I'm like, it makes me so sad. So yeah, I feel like it's cool to have the first track be definitely the more silent, honest space, and then the second track is like the sucker punch that kind of brings the album theme more into focus, if that makes sense. Yeah, I feel like for me, the song is written more about like personal experiences within relationships, not necessarily about the music business. Because fuck, nothing's more boring than bands writing about being bands, is it? Like, when bands make records about touring or make records about, oh, this record deal went bad, I'm like, nobody can relate to that.
It's so boring. Who cares?
But yeah, like, I think at the time, I don't think we weren't like, let's write a song that's about this. It was just something that came out, and the opening line of the song, He Said You Bore Me to Death, was a line that I'd had in a notebook, and when I found that was what came out. And so it must have all been, it came out quite quickly lyrically. I think it was like a day or so, maybe a couple of days, and
it goes there right away, so if I remember rightly.
Oh yeah, they feel like I'm losing my mind was in there quite quickly. Yeah, so it must mean that it was all buried in the subconscious somewhere. But it's been really amazing, honestly. I'm sure every musician says this, but to see people's response to it, because, you know, when you're writing, I don't think that you're thinking about, oh, this will connect with somebody, or if I say this someone could relate. It's more that you're trying to figure something out or communicate it. So if somebody feels seen and sees themselves in that, then there's something for that. And also, a lot of music isn't written for women. It's not written by women. It's not written about those experiences. So if people, especially women, can find something in that, I think that that's very, very powerful. I feel like at this point, I've known these guys for so long, I don't really feel self-conscious showing them lyrics anymore. Like, I definitely was, like, album one, album two, I was like, ooh. please don't make me sing it to you, just let me record it and then that will be the end and we'll never speak of it. But yeah, now I feel like everybody knows each other well enough and we know each other's tastes. And yeah, I'm more worried, like maybe the night before a single comes out I'm like, fuck, what if I've done a terrible job? But I feel like we all know and trust each other enough that we know that there's support and encouragement but there's quality control, so I never worry about that. And I guess, yeah, we've all, as much as I'm the only female in the band, I'm like, we've all been standing next to each other for 10 years through the professional stuff, through the personal stuff. So as much as these guys haven't experienced certain things firsthand, like they've had like a passenger seat looking at it for a very long time. So yeah, I'm grateful that you guys weren't like, what, don't put that in a song, that's fucking terrible, I don't want to play along, I don't want to play that, that's awful. So yeah. No.
California was one of these songs where it's sunny here all the time, right? And that can put people in a particular mood. And I always thought that it was kind of a fun idea to play around with that. And Lauren really took the ball and ran with it. And so I remember I had this loop that was like the do-do-do, and there's like a kind of like a vocal sample. And I decided to write a whole song around that. And like those lush guitar chords are very kind of PCH, very kind of like Don Henley, like designed to be sort of like quite, you know, I don't feel like we're an American sounding band, but I was definitely playing around with that when I was like writing that initial idea. And Lauren was like, yeah, no one ever warns you, you'll die in California. I'm like, that's the fucking line. I was like, whoa, okay, yeah, we're doing the ultimate juxtaposition, which is like, yeah, the sunshine, yeah, the fucking driving beats and like all of this like lush instrumental, but the message is not, hey, it's so great to live in LA. The message is, oh my god, you might get stuck here, you'll probably fail and you're going to die alone and poor. And I was like, fuck yeah, that's a lyric I can get behind.
Like, I think we had the shape of the chorus and I knew that the opening line, at first I was singing it as like, you, no one ever warns you. And I was like, what's going to be the next bit? What's going to be the next bit? For ages. And then I'd rewatched the film Lost Boys around that time because I was watching a lot of horror movies to try and channel that kind of imagery into the songs. And I was like, I like the idea that for me, that lyric is really literal. Like Martin and I moved literally to California to try and get other jobs and writing and expanding the horizons, and then you may well quite literally die alone in California because you were a careerist, ambitious person.
The failure aspect.
So, you know, and it was like everybody was obviously incredibly isolated last year, but there's something particular about being an Englishman in New York or whatever it is, it stings sense, you know, and like you were isolated within the isolation, like there's no way to even in an emergency situation drive to your family, like you can't, there's no way. So, and I guess like, yeah, so for me, the California line is kind of literal, but I also wanted California to be like an idea, like whatever it is that you've prioritized over the things that matter, like you're always trying to get to this fictional thing that you're sold, this idea that we all have to, we sacrifice everything in our lives to get this, and then reality dictated that that doesn't fucking matter. And what were all the people that, what happened to all the things that you put to one side, all the people that you didn't prioritize, and you got the thing, and what did it really matter, you know? Wow. But then we made it sunny and fun.
I just think it was kind of fun that you rhyme ya with California, which is like the, it's kind of like the, it's the whole song in a device, like the whole, it's like that, the tone of it is that's the whole song. Like the, what's that, ordinarily you'd be like, I'm not rhyming ya with ya.
That's very fucking strict with my rhyming.
And the word is you, it's not ya, but it's like in this context, I think if you or from a musicology point of view, if you look into it and you get it, then it opens up the whole meaning. And it's actually perfect. And I just think that's a really kind of interesting Easter egg that some people might pass over.
Yeah, no one ever warns you, you'll die in Timbuktu. Wouldn't really.
Yeah, no, taking a shit on the loo. There you go. Today, let's fuck it. Today, Violent Delights is my favorite song on the album.
Oh.
It changes all the time. Because it's an unusual place for us production wise. Like, I guess we were thinking about Ian and I always talk about Music for the Jilted Generation by The Prodigy as being like one of the most pioneering, most important electronic records ever from the UK. We used to like talking about the idea of using those type of like ravey breaks and in the context of CHVRCHES. Mm-hmm. We never actually got around to trying it until now, if I remember rightly. And I think I took like, it was a splice loop or something, and I just took this really fast splice loop and I started cutting up the two track. And instead of us going for the whole, once we got this kind of weird beat that was sort of based on it, I just took the, instead of going down the route of like, now we have to put this ravey element and that ravey element and this ravey element. And it was more like, okay, right, what is this? If this is actually like a really emotional kind of cinematic, expansive track, but it's getting driven, driving the car is like Liam Howlett in like fucking 1991. That to me was really like an interesting juxtaposition. Then Ian and I were able to take the ball and really run with production once we kind of had that idea that that was going to be the flavor.
Yeah, I feel like overall, not specifically this song, but definitely this song, there's a kind of dreamlike theme that runs through this record. I mean, I guess like, you know, movies, horror movies, cult movies, whatever, all tend to have a kind of unreal sort of fantasy dreamlike quality about them. And I feel like that's kind of, if I think about it, it's sort of like an overarching theme of the whole record, that it sort of feels dreamlike. There's a lot of references to dreams. And there's a lot of sort of spacey guitar and vocal production that sort of bring that about even more. So I feel like that's the song. Probably one of the first songs that we wrote on for this record that really started to inhabit that sort of feeling. And I love it. It's also it's maybe not my total favorite song for the day. I think that's asking for a friend. But I love this song so much. It doesn't really sound like anything else to me, which is what really excites me about it.
Just the double devil horns. Yeah. I feel like every time we talk about this, I feel like a broken record to say the same thing every time. But like, yeah, it's still mental that we got to do that, and he's been such a huge influence on all of us and on this band specifically. So the fact that he heard anything that he wanted to work on in what we'd made is is baffling and mind-boggling and kind of the best cosign you could ever get, really. So yeah, and yeah, he was so creatively generous and made so much space for everybody and contributed so much. And yeah, hearing his voice on that song is like, I don't think I'll ever get over that. Like, you know, like
a little bit of poop just come out.
emotional poop.
I'm not just poop.
I mean, in fact, that was me on the third album when I worried myself into like a broken body. I was just like covered in rashes and shit in my pants all the time.
The IBS, you know.
Brutal. Yes, it was like, and then going to the doctor and they're like, are you dealing with any anxiety? And I was like, oh. It's bad. They're like, aha, you say that your face expands and explodes just like on a daily basis. Do you think that maybe it might be you? And I'm like, no, it can't be. Anyway.
Robert Smith.
Yes, but. And obviously we were like, please rewrite anything you want, like lyrically especially, please change whatever you want. But yeah, I feel like that was the song that he connected with out of what we'd sent him. And it was such a bizarre way for it to come about, really, but a very on-brand way. Like if we ever like really try to do something, it never seems like it pans out the way that we hope. So the best things that have happened to us have always been really happy, random accidents. Maybe because this band is kind of a happy, happy accident in a lot of ways. But our manager had been, this is a very CHVRCHES story, but our manager had been talking to our lawyer about something, because you got to have a lawyer. This is my advice for people getting into music business. I'm like, work on your craft, get a good lawyer and an accountant. those are the only things. But yes, he'd been, Campbell, our manager, was talking to him and asking what he'd been up to. And he was like, I've been working on the new Cure contracts because they're almost finished their record. And Campbell was like, oh, could you pass my information to their manager just in case I can pitch the band for our tour support or something? Because we dream big, but not that big. You know, we were like, maybe we can get on the tour, which would be amazing anyway. But, and then he got an email from Robert Smith because he doesn't have a manager. And the email was like, dear Campbell, I hear you're looking for me. What do you want? And Campbell was like, ah, and had to like call us and be like, what do you want? I know I didn't tell anybody this was happening, but what do you want? And we were like, everything? I don't know. Yeah, so we just kind of went on email and sent a bunch of songs, and it ended up that he wanted to play on one. So fuck.
I mean, it's like a real symbol of, like, I don't want to say struggle, because I mean, I'm a fucking Scottish white guy that's had a fine life. I'm not, it's not like real struggle, but like, mental health is kind of a dirty word if you come from a working class Scottish background. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, people don't really talk about their emotions, especially males. They don't talk about their feelings. And yeah, that was written in a really dark place. But like, I could go through probably 80% of our catalogue and say, dark place, dark place, dark place, dark place. Or, oh, that one was a happy one. That was a good day. Like, there's, you get, if I've done the start on a track, there's like, it's like a sine wave, but that's just like what depression is. Like, you don't, it's not always good or bad. You get kind of everything in between. But enough about that, because the song itself is like, I just, it kind of became symbolic for me, because I mean, it's really easy to go back to that point where it felt pretty hopeless, and I felt really fucking isolated, and like I didn't want to be in the band, or like I didn't want to do, I didn't know what I wanted to do in life. Mm-hmm. To, oh, here's a finished track with your idol. I've just made the album that you love so much with like your bandmates and collaborators of 10 years. It's kind of like the ultimate reality check. Like, even in that moment where it feels so real and you feel like so angry, or you feel so like you just, you're never, that it's never going to be cool again. That is very rarely the facts of it. Like, every therapist says feelings aren't facts. Like, because at the end of the journey, you're like, oh my God, look at all these fucking amazing things that we've done. And if you do go, if you can be objective, you can take a step back, you can be like, oh my God, wouldn't, if on that day I had gone, fuck this, fuck the world, walked out that venue and never come back, it would have been the biggest mistake of my life. And I would have lived forever, like, regretting it. So it's kind of like, I think of it as something that is so special to me and so important. And it makes me so happy thinking about it now. But it's the ultimate reality check.
I think once we had a few songs in the bag, we kind of knew, it felt like we knew where we were going in terms of the story. And I definitely wanted to put that kind of imagery throughout the record, just because we had the title first. So we knew what we were working off of. And I think at the beginning, I thought it would, before we started writing, I was like, oh, it'll be super concept heavy. That's what it's going to be. But then the first two songs that came out were He Said, She Said and Good Girls, which aren't really more in the horror space as much. So when we were getting further into the process, it felt like there was more space for that. And I've always been really drawn to horror movies because I think when I look at it, I'm like, it's helping you unpack fear in your subconscious. I think that's maybe why we're all attracted to it, because we're all terrified of something. And this record and the stories we were trying to tell, I feel like it was important for there to be discussion around female narratives in that. And all women know what it is like to feel watched, to feel hunted, to feel like you're negotiating for your safety, for your life, for your sanity. Like, everybody knows that. Women instinctively know certain things. You know instinctively the difference between a certain kind of hello from somebody in a bar and another kind of hello. You instinctively know if you're walking in front of somebody and you hear someone walking behind you, you don't walk faster because that will make that other person, you'll make the situation worse. You know, nobody ever told me put my keys between my fingers or have your keys out your bag before you get to the door. You just know this stuff. So I feel like I wanted that kind of voyeurism and feeling of disturbance, I guess, to be in the record. And I like that this song is probably the most like knowing wink to that kind of imagery. Like, I like the idea that you can kind of visualize a final girl like running for the horizon, and everybody that like who's writing it and listening to it is like, fuck, is she gonna make it? We don't know. But ultimately, as much as the record has some heavy themes, I feel like a lot of it is about not perseverance, but like hope, I guess, and trying to make it to that horizon. And that's something that hopefully everybody can connect with, whether they're male or female. Mm.
Yeah,
I think it's a like really good metaphor.
Sorry.
No, please.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, and on that note of hope, it's sort of like when the chorus kicks in, you know, it almost switches to like a much more hopeful mode. You know, it kind of goes into the major and it's like, it sounds really bright and upbeat. In contrast to, you know, some of the lyrics and some of the verse treatment as well. So, yeah, I think that sort of helps helps the story of the song. What are you going to say, Martin? Sorry.
I just think it's kind of an interesting metaphor, like the final girl in the context of like the modern society, or Lauren's perspective, or like her experience in the band. I just remember thinking, she said, I've got this idea. And my first thing was like, if you want to quit. And when I read the chorus, no one's holding you here against your will. And then I like looked at the lyrics overall. I was like, oh shit, this is something broader and cooler. And I love the idea of the final girl. You're not saying, here we are at the end of the horror movie. And you're saying, here I am at a junction and like where like I've been through some shit. Mm. And like I've been had fire set to me for things that have been said publicly in the band, or things that are just fucking existing in a space that makes people feel uncomfortable for whatever crazy reason. Not to speak for you, Lauren, but I just like thought that that was an interesting point of view, and it was a nice way to, I don't think you're having fun with it, but like when you say like a knowing wink, I think I was, oh, that's a fucking great idea, because not only does it make sense in the context of this whole aesthetic, but it's metaphorically, it's fucking genius. Well, you know, I didn't write it, so I can say that. And maybe everyone will hate it and we'll be like, lol, now we've got egg on our face. But like, I just thought lyrically that was really fucking special.
You complimented me in front of the cat. That's great.
Oh, there we go. It's the main lady, the lady of the house.
one of not the present two for interviews. Furry ladies.
Yeah.
Poppy does not care to be present for interviews. Cactus likes to know what's up. Anyway. But oh, thanks, man. That's good. I think with that one, I was like, oh God, what if it's too far? Do you know what I mean? Like the imagery and also the sentiments. Like, I feel like, I guess that's growth. Like on the last record, I would never have written a chorus that's it's like super literal and super imagery laden at the same time. Mm-hmm. Like, but I always like that. I'm like, if you can have the two things right next to each other, so it feels like the fact and the fiction at the same time. Was Good Girls is the second song that we wrote? Mm-hmm. I think it was. Mm-hmm. And it was based off of Ian had sent us a demo that had, I think, is all the melodies from it, or it's the pre and the chorus?
Not the verse. Not the verse melodies. And then you guys sort of tweaked the things that are sent across.
Yeah.
But yeah, like the da 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 was in that demo. So, which I think your demo was called Little by Little. I think I remember that. I remember that because I was like, little by little. And I was like, it's not that. It's not that. It's
but, is that Oasis?
I think so. Is it not one?
I don't know. It's like a latter Oasis track. Shouts really? Out to the fucking later no day Oasis, like crazy songs.
But terrible yeah, so. Song. Is it? I don't know. I don't know enough about the Oasis canon to know. Yeah. Although I do know that Liam Gallagher does some stuff where he reviews. For some show, he was reviewing tracks on the internet. And when he doesn't like it, he's obviously matured in some ways because he was like, not for me. That is the biggest slagging. And I'm like, that's not going to do that when someone asks me about something rather than having to give it. I'll just be like, just not for me. But yeah, so Ian had sent us that demo and we kind of constructed the choruses out of that. And then, yeah, lyrically, with the opening line of the song is like killing your idols is a chore, and that was something that was written down in my notebook from like maybe a couple of years ago. And Yeah, again, I don't think we were like, let's write a message song. It was more just like, we're sold this idea that bad things don't happen to good girls. Like, if you abide by all the rules and you do all the things that you're supposed to do, then you will be accepted. You will be like, you can be just lean in. You'll be a success. You can be as successful as you want. You can be as happy as you want. You can do anything, but you just have to abide by these rules and then nothing bad will happen to you. And my limited experience of that is that it's a fucking load of shit. That's not true. It's not true. It's just another part of this thing that we're all sold. And it's like how you have to edit and focus group yourself into oblivion to try and appeal to a standard. And it's never going to be enough because it's not about, throwing it bitten by a cat at the same time. It's not, that's not good girls don't. Good girls don't
bite the person that feeds them.
I know, look at this bastard. I think it might be time for you to exit the interview, perhaps. She doesn't want
Gave
to.
It a go.
She's just got something to say about the song, that's all.
No, she's like, you bite my trousers. That's what I get for raising teeny furry feminists. Little furry feminists. But yeah, I feel like it was a cathartic one to write, but it's definitely, I like the imagery of it, especially in terms of like it does fit into the horror inspired canon because it is like, those are the rules. Those are the Scream movie rules. It's like, if you're make yourself pretty and blonde and acceptable and don't do any of those things and exist only in this way to please only these people. And then you get murdered in a garage door anyway.
I think that I did the start for this one in a lockdown time. I think that this song and Nightmares were kind of like a couplet. Like that there was, those two things were written. I would have to go back and get the sessions, but I think they were like days apart or maybe one after the other directly. I was on the same thing that Ian was talking about before that we really expand on together in these productions is the kind of like, lush kind of guitar playing and the keyboards that sound like guitars and the guitars that sound like keyboards. And we have also been listening to and mining the Blue Nile since like since we've ever been in a band. I think they're the most influential band ever from Scotland, and in my opinion remain to me the most important Scottish act, and that's amongst a lot of music that I respect, obviously, that's come from my home country. So that's kind of like the really high praise. We're thinking about, you know, there's a song they have. Maybe we shouldn't go too much into it. Whatever. I want to get sued. I know, like, I once worked for the Blue Nile, actually, and I know Paul, and, like, I love him so much. So if he happens to see this, please don't sue us. You know, I love you. We wanted to do the really driving, really simple, like, Lindrum sounding, like, single, like, kick, snare, drum beat. And have the whole sonics move around that and like shift and kind of have this beautiful tension that releases into this like kind of soundscape. And the Ian was like to me, well, why don't we just go the whole road and I'll do this like crazy like string arrangement? And I was like, are you sure we won't get sued if you like go all that way and like do this crazy string arrangement? And so Ian started doing these like chop. I don't think we intended to chop them up. And then, like, he, like, went and did all this beautiful, like, arranging. And then I heard it and was like, well, maybe we just don't chop it up because that's fucking perfect. All right, let's just move on. Next. So and that stayed, like, in the track as it was. And
Yes. I was just going to say those little string flourishes, I think, are one of my favourite parts on the record. Like, those cat flourishes. And also, do you like She's Returned and she knows she's cleaning her arse?
Yeah, Cactus is just like, I'm off.
She left and then she has returned and there's fluff everywhere. What is going on? Yeah, there was. I rewrote the lyrics to this so many times. I think this was the most troublesome lyrically because we couldn't. It makes a lot of sense that we talk about it in hindsight. It's like we knew what the feeling of it should be and I just couldn't get that right. It had like three or four different titles or something. And then this is what we ended up on. And it's weird to think about it now because I think the lyrics for Lullabies and Nightmares were written in the same time period because of when the tracks came about. And it is kind of funny to think about Lullabies, Nightmares. These things thematically are connected. But I don't know if you're even conscious of that when you're making it sometimes. I like the idea of the Lullabies thing because it feels like last year especially, like you were reaching for the things that would bring you comfort and make you feel better and make you feel safe, but nothing could really do that. And it was like diminishing returns, the stuff that normally would make you feel better or feel happier isn't working anymore because the world is terrifying. One of the things I've always thought is interesting about how people talk about the band is that there's a perception that we write a lot of relationship songs, and I don't necessarily know if that's the case, like romantic relationship songs, but I guess that's what everybody projects on songs, different things, and that's what's great about lyrics. But I feel like this is the only song on the record that's actually about in any relationship. So I would be like, oh no, I hope this person doesn't hear it, but let's be honest, he's not going to make it to track 9, is he? I don't even think he listened to the records when we were actually dating, so I don't think he would bother now. But yeah, like,
just to send me, it to him.
Just like, directly, just, that one MP3.
Just DM that one song. What up,
Beth?
But yeah, like, but ultimately, I don't want it to be, it wasn't meant to be, it sounds pretentious, but even when you write relationship songs, I feel like most of the time I'm writing about myself rather than the other person, if that makes sense. So maybe the verses are outward looking, but the choruses are definitely like inward looking. Like, I feel like it's about being disappointed in the fucking terrible choices that you make because you are responsible for your own life. And then I guess, yeah, like, I like the idea of a metaphor of like a song and a process for your life. Like, when you're singing that same song again, you're writing these songs about these things, but you're choosing what you're writing about, and you're like the cycle that you put yourself in, and you're giving yourself this trauma and these terrible experiences by being like, that sounds great, sign me up for more of that.
I remember the track was written when I first moved to LA. I did what every fucking idiot, like, guy, bachelor that moves to LA does and gets this house with, like, a view and shit. Like, and I remember it being really an unusually grey and rainy day in Los Angeles, and I was sitting looking out the window, fucking mega sad boy, like, missing home, lonely, the usual shit. And I was playing this guitar the way that, like, I used to play guitar when I was 18, or the way I used to play guitar in the bands that I was in back home, like two notes and these types of shapes and these types of chords. And it was kind of like it was a comfort thing. And then just hit on this melody and this whole thing. I was like, fuck, that's pretty good. And my girlfriend at the time, who is now my fiance, came in round and was like, what the fuck is that? I was like, I don't know what. She's like, did you write that? I was like, yeah. She's like, I like that. But, well, I guess, okay. I guess that's probably a good one. And I cut it and then it went in a pile for like, it's just like a year and a half and it resurfaced during the process of this album. And this is the one of the ones that, I mean, Ian, you know that we did there's like a rave banger version of this track. There's a somewhere in between version of this track. There's a like kind of like a, like, well, I think we produced it out three times,
yeah,
including the original demo. And then it was like, it's not right. And the lyrics were there, and I think it was like the lyrics that are most special to me on this album. I was really fucking identify with them. Lauren was kind of leading the charge, was like, no, something's not right. It's not right.
Like, I know, like, you guys spent days and days doing this, but yeah, no. Yeah.
Like, you're just making it worse, guys.
I know.
Like, stop.
I know that you guys want a festival banger out of this for some fucking insane reason, but it's just not supposed to be that.
It's not happening.
No. And we went back to the, you hear that guitar, I think maybe overdubbed another one, but the same, like, out of tune, like, fucked guitar that I still recorded in there. Through. A really like non-professional setup is like still on the song, and you hear all the noise from it and stuff, and it's kind of almost in tune, and it's being played in that like way, or like the way that someone plays when they're just discovering these shapes for the first time. And that became like, oh shit, this is the point of this song, like, this is what was cool about it. So what you hear is pretty close to the original demo, I think, in the end.
Yeah, and I feel like for me, like, lyrically, it's homesickness for a place, but also for like a moment in time. Like, I know that sounds weird, but I think that's what I'm, when I think of home, I can visualize in my mind like a certain time period of my life and what that looked like, what that felt like. And I feel like a lot of people have that sensation when you're like, fuck, I wish I could go, not go back to that space, but there's something about that moment in that period in your life when you're experiencing lots of things for the first time and like what those things mean to you, and you can't go back. Was it one of you guys? Somebody said to me recently, and I was like, oh, excuse me while I lie down on the ground and sob. They were like, yeah, I've got money can buy people anything, but it can never buy people more time.
That's like my mantra right now. It's like, some, I heard a quote somewhere that says, people in the end, when they die, they never say, I wish I had more money. They say, I wish I had more time. That's like the, so when I'm so obsessed with money and spending time on like trying to get rich, it makes me think, oh, you know, not in the band. This is where you're my art, darling.
In your crypto life.
In my investment portfolio. What a dick. I'm like, why am I spending so much fucking time on this? Because in the end, what we want is more time, not more money. I have enough money. Like, whatever, I can live and, you know, have a work. And that's all that anybody should really ever need. Mm-hmm. I think that anything above that's kind of vulgar. You know, I'm afraid to die. It's like,
and there we go, full circle.
You know, I don't want to die. And I don't want to spend, imagine you get to your end of your life and you were like, oh, I was never happy because I was always trying to get somewhere else. What a waste of time that was. Fuck.
Well, and
I wish someone told me that 50 years ago.
As fucked and uneven and morally incorrect as it is, you're like, incredibly wealthy people can kind of buy their way into basically anything, but that's the one that you can send a fucking idiot into space, but like you can't, nobody, like, you know, money can get you any of those things. Money, as we saw, money can get people private travel to like fancy ass islands during a pandemic. It can give people early access to vaccines. Like, it's disgusting and vulgar that that's possible, but the only thing that money can't buy you is like more time.